Now I will highlight a few reviews that shed light on opportunities to do research or to fill gaps in research related to disasters and humanitarian crises. In this scoping review of health research linked to disasters in 43 low and middle income countries, the investigators identified earthquakes and tsunamis as the most common disasters in the selected articles. About half of the articles in terms of the methods, they consisted of cross-sectional studies and 17% of them retrospective analysis. And they also reported mixed methods used in hurricane-related and tsunami-related studies, but it was in less than half of them. In terms of research topics, mental health was the most common research topic. And of note, mental health tends to be one of the first interventions in disasters response and recovery, and a common research topic in disaster research. Now, congruent with the most common disasters that were reported in the articles that were chosen for the review, traumatology and surgery would be expected to be among the top research topics. So that's congruent with the findings. In contrast, chronic conditions, non-communicable and chronic diseases here, made less than 2% of the literature in low and middle income countries. As chronic non-communicable diseases have been increasingly recognized in low and middle income countries, and to which a great public health burden has been attributed, more attention to this area of research, especially in the management of chronic diseases, should be emphasized. In this other scoping review on natural disasters in the Caribbean, the authors included 17 articles published between 1974 and 2020. They noted that most of the articles were descriptive and qualitative. And they also noted that the burden and management of chronic diseases was often overlooked. But they also observed some challenges and potential strategies within the context of the management of chronic diseases. And the challenges were basically categorized into two groups: disrupted healthcare systems and food insecurity. And within disrupted healthcare systems, that manifested at least in a limited access to medications, remote medical advice, or direct in-person visits. Infrastructure problems, especially on the disruption of supply and cold chains, structural damages of the healthcare facilities, and disruption of communications. In terms of strategies to enhance access to medications, some investigators recommended and or tried a centralized pharmacy registry, medication distribution centers, incorporating pharmacists into the dispensation of medications, especially at evacuation shelters, and trying alternative medications when the brand name medications were not available. Importantly, education of the individual, of the patient, on being prepared for any catastrophe, for power outages, for prolonged problematic access to medications, and on self-management was important and highly recommended, and capitalize on social media when the internet is available, because social media can reach out multiple people and promote education to a large group of individuals. And they definitely pointed out that robust disease surveillance systems are key for the identification of non-communicable diseases, but also tracking its management. In this publication, the authors discussed the potential consequences of disasters in different healthcare system scenarios. And they are using modeling to demonstrate the potential effects. The authors define surge capacity as the provision of medical care to a large volume of persons during an acute response, and secondary surge capacity as the sustained ability of the healthcare system to expand operational resources to meet the increased need and demand of during the long-term recovery. So using this model in this first diagram that you are seeing on the screen, the authors illustrate a scenario in which the primary care needs are met and the system is working under capacity. And you can see that the system, the primary care needs are below the maximum surge capacity. Within this context or example, the system is able to absorb or to respond to the acute response and to manage the healthcare needs without being overwhelmed or going overboard. So the system remains stable throughout the response and the recovery. In this second example, the system is under capacity at baseline, like the previous system. The disaster or the event occurs, but the primary care needs eventually start to increase. And these may happen when factors outside of the healthcare are affected. For instance, we have mentioned power outages or maybe roadblocks or problems with transportation or food insecurity are going to promote exacerbation of chronic diseases and therefore a higher demand of medical services sometime after the event and the response. So the system becomes suddenly overcapacity, but the system has the ability to respond and come back to normal. So in this case, the system can manage and recovers a few years later. In the third scenario, the system is also at less than capacity or less than maximum at baseline. The disaster or the event happens, but the overwhelming number of complications now exceeds much more than what the system can handle. And the recovery or the return to normal is unknown. And this may be due to characteristics of the population in addition to other factors outside of healthcare. For example, do we have people with multiple chronic diseases in this community? And do we have people with disabilities or who need certain services like dialysis or children with special needs? And so depending on the characteristics of the population and other factors, then they merge and the ability of the system to respond in the long term is affected. In the fourth scenario, it's a system in which the population has baseline health or healthcare disparities. So at baseline, that system is already overwhelmed. The system is not able to really provide all the services and supply all the needs that the population has. This is at baseline. When the disaster happens, when the event happens, then the system, which is already overwhelmed, is going to be even more overwhelmed. And definitely a return to baseline is unknown, much more than scenario C. I would like to point out a couple of things about this modeling, which is very helpful to understand the possibilities when we are working in disasters, and especially within the context of populations with health disparities or healthcare disparities. First, in these diagrams, the events are similar. They are similarly shaped, the similar length. I mentioned before that the disasters vary by type and intensity and magnitude. So if a disaster is of lesser magnitude or greater magnitude, the shape of the curves and the ability to come back to normal may vary depending on the scenario. Other factors that could influence the shape of these curves and the potential of responding is going to be migration of medical personnel, because in the same way that the general population, the community may migrate because of the circumstances are not really appropriate to remain in the place where they used to live. The same thing can happen to the healthcare workforce. They can also migrate. Also the physical damages to health facilities, the disruption of transportation and delivery of medications, and other factors that we have already mentioned may prolong the recovery. And the systems return to normal, and especially in this scenario D, we don't even know, will they come back to baseline? This baseline, which is already overwhelmed, will they become to a much lower baseline? Will they become stronger, more efficient? Or will they have a higher baseline? What will be the impact of the disaster? And my other comment is, we know, and I mentioned at the beginning, some of us live in areas that are prone to not one, not two, but multiple disasters. So how would this model look within the context of communities that are exposed to disasters in a cyclical manner? Those are questions that are important to ask and answer, because that will give us a better idea on how to prepare that population, how to prepare those healthcare systems. This is a related example to the modeling that I just mentioned, but this is real life. And this is not a review, this is information from two hurricanes. And it's based on tracking of the opening of pharmacies in Puerto Rico after Hurricane Maria, that happened in 2017, and the opening of pharmacies in Florida after Hurricane Irma, that happened more or less in this the same month, September of 2017. But again, Florida is a state, is mainland United States, and Puerto Rico is a US territory, is an archipelago in the Caribbean. In this figure, we see that pharmacies opening rate for in Florida, in the blue-gray dots that you see, 90% of the pharmacies were already open by day four. It took about 4 days for the pharmacies to be completely open or back to normal. But it took 31 days in Puerto Rico to start seeing some kind of normalcy. Also, overall, the pharmacy operations in Puerto Rico recovered 10 times slower compared to pharmacy operations in Florida, and this during the same hurricane season. Why is the difference? I mentioned a couple of differences. Puerto Rico is an archipelago in the Caribbean. Florida is mainland US. And hurricanes hit Puerto Rico, 80%, 85% of the goods in Puerto Rico are imported. So when the hurricane hits, transportation, the weather doesn't allow for the normal transportation and business to take place. Also, there was a massive power outage across the archipelago, So internet communication and even telephone communication, all digital communication was impaired for a long time. So these circumstances, these are examples of non-healthcare factors that impact health and health services during disasters. So considering the challenges, strategies, and the published health research linked to humanitarian crises and the gaps in research that we have discussed, it is clear that some of these gaps could be turned into opportunities. And the following is a non-exhaustive list of topics or research questions. And we talked about research methods and ethics, and demographic changes and subsequent health care needs, especially on the projected impact on healthcare systems, the long-term effects on health and healthcare systems, especially anticipated needs in an overwhelmed or fragile system, how medical referrals and specialized health services could be maintained during disasters, and the impact of healthcare workforce migration and relocation, the burden and management of chronic diseases and how to maintain continuity of care during these events, and reducing the disruption on access to medications and devices and preventing hospitalizations and fatalities. Also, effective ways to really implement emergency preparedness and recovery plans, strategies to maintain operations, coalitions, hospitals, clinics, nonprofit organizations, community organizations, schools, academic institutions, non-academic institutions, plans for service specific care units, possible planning for people who have specific healthcare needs that could go to a place where those could be provided, providing fuel, water, food, medication storage. Effects of pre-existing policies, like we mentioned before, community healthcare, community and healthcare system partnerships. Important that in some communities, local leaders are very creative and they are working at home with the community on preventing problems and also maintaining health, and how those ideas and strategies could be performed or in a collaboration with healthcare systems. Training of workforce and the impact of serial or multiple disasters. And something I mentioned at the beginning, despite all the circumstances, despite all these multiple adversities, some individuals and communities maintain a degree of resilience that could shed a lot of light to us, to anyone. Resilience that could be from molecular level to population level, and what we can learn that we could implement and prepare for disasters better.